What up, everyone? Corey Taylor here from Slipknot and Stone Sour.
Hey, what's up, everybody? This is JD.
This is Ray.
This is Head.
From the band Korn.
Hey, this is Tom Maxwell.
And Chad Gray from Hell Yeah.
This is Zach Wild.
Hey, what's up? This is Sean from See That.
This is Jack Black, and you're listening to Tattness Radio.
You're listening to Tattness Radio.
You're listening to Tattness Radio.
The best in uncensored entertainment. Tattness Radio. You're listening to
Tattness Radio. With your Tattness McCreary and Donald Sullivan.
Never made it as a wise man.
Shut up, Meg.
Welcome once again to Tattness Radio. First and foremost, happy Father's Day to all the dads out there that love their kids. I don't give a fuck what your circumstances are, whether they're alive and well or no longer with us. You get to see them every day. You don't get to see them as much as you like. You don't get to see them at all. Does not matter. If you love your kids, man, today is your day. Happy Father's Day. And I hope it's a good one, man. This is the Ask Me Anything show, part two. You guys have so many damn questions. I had to break this sumbitch up into two parts. So we're going to get right into some of your questions before we get into some music. Let's start off with Anton Fong. What is it like working with people you grew up a fan of? And thank you for giving fans hope that they too could work with their heroes. Hey man, thank you so much. It's surreal as hell, let's just say that. Whenever I sit and I think about it, I'm like, damn dude, it's a small fucking world to sit and think. All these people that I grew up watching their work, listening to their work, a massive fan of it, and now they're dear friends of mine, mentors of mine, brothers, big brothers, you know. It's pretty fucking trippy, dude. It's a small world, it's fucking surreal. And thank you for that last part, because it is true. It can fucking be something that happens to y'all. Just shoot for whatever it is you're after, man. You can do anything. Catherine Jensen, if I were in your room right now, what would you want to do to me? Call the fucking cops. Like, who are you? Why are you in my room? Who sent you? I want answers. Fucking weirdo. Just kidding. Vicky Baldwin, what is your favorite sexual position? You know what, man? Honestly, just like any award show or any role that I'm told to audition for, asked to audition for, I'm grateful to be considered and just happy to be invited, man. Jay Demers, thank you so much for answering my question. I'm such a fan. Oh, thank you, bro. What movie do you feel is criminally underrated? Grandma's Boy, easily. That's a no-brainer to me, man. You don't hear enough about that movie, but the people that do love it, my God, do they love it. I feel like more people need to see it, more people need to know what it is, and I think it's one of the best Adam Sandler movies he's ever done that he's not actually in, so I just love it. It makes me laugh every time. I've seen it at least 100 times. I'll see it 100,000 more. It's just so fucking funny to me, man. Claudia Mercer, would you rather give up your favorite food or give up sex? Hey, man. You know, a diet never hurt nobody. You know what I'm saying? Megan LeBlanc asks, have any other celebrities disappointed you? Yes, actually. There is only one time I can say I was truly disappointed by a fellow celebrity, and that was, The voice actor that does Skeletor's voice. He was someone I grew up watching He-Man, and I love the cartoon, and I really thought it'd be cool to have him on my other show. And I reached out, and his agent responded saying it's $800 and some odd for 45 minutes of his time. And I'm like, yo, first of all, man, I'm sorry, not trying to be petty, not trying to be disrespectful, but I've had much more recognizable names that, even before they were friends of mine, came on my fucking show and became friends of mine that did it out of respect for me and for what I do, and that they, you know, appreciated what I do. So I've never had to pay a celebrity to do my show before. I'm not about to start now. And I get it, man. This is how some people, you know, put food on their table still, because they're not doing the voice work anymore or whatever, but I don't know, man. It was just disappointing, very disheartening. It was the only negative experience I had. And it's not that he was a dick or anything. It's not all that negative. It was just, you know, to find out that he values his time that fucking much, as we all probably should, but to a degree, right? Erica Nixon asks, is it hot in here or is it just you? Well, I don't even know what that means, but as seeing it's Father's Day and I'm a father, don't touch the goddamn thermostat. Let's get to some music, you fucking legends. And I'll get back to your questions. You guys are too damn much, man. You guys are fucking nuts.
He didn't have much. A pair of hardworking hands. Everything that I needed, I got it from the old man. With the 9-second dream, he drove the red light Bennett. And the grease on his hands was the way he commanded. And the life he demanded, it kept us all in a struggle. When he ruled with his fists, it kept us all out of trouble. Even though he would leave, he wore his heart on his sleeve. By the way that he walked, he taught me how to believe. His heart felt like breaking. He looked right up at the ceiling and start again. Never breathe a word of his loss. Cause it's not about winning, it's the rivers you cross. And the pain that you feel could be the fuel that you use. And if you need the direction, be it the path that you choose. My old man is a legend, he casts a shadow so great. I think of how he is watching with every move that I make. Setting the pace, no more dreams to be stolen, just the right ones to chase. And you've been through the worst, now you know who to trust. Leave them something behind before the ashes and dust.
Okay, you beautiful legends, back to your questions. Kelly Morris asks, where did you grow up? I grew up in two different places, really. I spent a lot of my life in between two different places. One would be Malton, Ontario, and that's not to be mistaken with Milton, Ontario, because that's a completely different place. Malton, Ontario was much more rough, and the other place was Brampton, Ontario, which is also kind of rough, but it's certainly no Malton, that's for damn sure. But I grew up in both, really, so I got a lot of good memories in both places. Jeanette Thorne asks, talking or texting? Neither, just leave me the fuck alone. No, kidding. It depends on the person, actually. I think, you know, I'm a huge text guy, but when it comes to certain people, like my wife, I would fucking love phone conversations. I love texting with her too, but I just prefer talking and hearing her voice. And so I guess it depends on the person. Ken Santos asks, how do you like your women? I like my women the same way I like my coffee, man, without some other guy's dick in it. Bridget Watson, how would you approach a scene when you don't get along with your scene partner? With professionalism. Here's the thing. We're all there to do a job. We're there to create something that entertains you guys. Our job is to entertain you, so personal matters like that should not get in the way of giving you what you're paying to see. So, you know, we're there to do a job, and professionalism is key. I don't think letting personal matters like that get in the way is a good look, so that's my approach to it, is just put it behind you, and if you can use it to fuel the scene in some way, go ahead, but always stay professional, stay classy. Alan McPherson says, you have mentioned a history with 7-Eleven. Would you ever eat a day-old taquito from 7-Eleven? Bro, I think if any of us that have ever had a taquito from 7-Eleven, whether we know it or not, probably ate a fucking day-old taquito from 7-Eleven. So, yeah, I probably would. What a weird question. Robin Willis. Super Mario Brothers or Zelda? Man, that's like asking, you know, to pick a favorite child of yours, man. Ah, fuck. You know what? Just for the longevity and how long it takes to actually beat the fucking game, I'm gonna have to go with Zelda on this one. Jane Scott. What's the most boring thing ever? I think that would be a tie between watching golf on TV or a Nickelback concert. Leanne Freeman, what's your best kept secret? Well, obviously the one I have never told anybody yet, duh. Trevor Christie, what are you most grateful for? My wife and kids, man. Krista Sabin asks, what quote do you live by? Everything happens for a reason. Connor Thompson asks, who is your favorite comedian? Dave Chappelle, easily. Joe Morrow asks, what is the best thing about being a public figure? Having a platform where you can actually make a difference, I would have to say, is definitely the big reward there. Sarah Tremblay, what was the first album you ever bought? Nirvana, Nevermind. So that one's the biggest thing memory-wise for me. Let's get some more music, man, and we'll get back to your questions.
Checking all the seats, but the only thing I saw was a bag of cocaine. Papa was too solid, he ain't never tell a lie. I went in to tell him about it, he said, oh, that must be God. He worked with me at the job, I said, oh, and walked away. He said, oh, before you go, make sure you don't tell your mom about the cocaine. Me and a little homie, we was walking to the store. It was right there on the corner. Then we seen the guy that's homeless. He was wrapped up in the blanket. He was looking really cold. Then he asked us for some change. Then he asked us if we know who had the cocaine. Cocaine. I'm losing my mind trying to figure out how did I inherit so much pain. I drink a lot of alcohol, problems with the law, but I have done better or the same. Daddy never tried. Okay. Daddy never tried cocaine. Okay.
So my father's only next logical step was to go to rehab. That's exactly what he did. He went to rehab and got completely clean. He hasn't did a drug in over 20 years. He did that for himself, but he did that because he didn't want to lose us. Whew, strong man.
Now let's talk about how much I respect my pop. He been through so much in life, we ain't never had a lot. We just had each other's back, that was really all we need. Pop, I love you unconditional, and thanks for loving me more than cocaine. My father tells me over cocaine. I'm proud to say that I'm an addict who inherits your pain.
Trust is broken. Words get choked.
Alyssa Dawson asks, if a movie was made about your life, what would be the genre and who would play you? That's a fucking great question, man. I don't know if I would say drama or maybe dark comedy with some of the shit that's gone on in my life. Maybe a mixture of both. And who would play me? I honestly could say that's a damn good question. That's very difficult to answer. Some people, like Sherry Nelson, the actress and model, had suggested Donnie Wahlberg. She said that's who I remind her of. And a couple other people have said that, but I feel like maybe a very disheveled Gary Busey might be a good fit. Oh my god. Great question. Thank you so much. Marlene Wheeler, who is your favorite cartoon character and why? Easily, I would have to say Gurr from Invader Zim, just because he is so simple-minded that he's actually very innocent, you know? And we both love tacos. Vince Barker, what is your favorite movie quote? Oh, here we go. Let me hit you with it.
Well, since you just picked this place out of the hat, my brother is dead. That girl's entire fucking family is dead.
What, were they psychos?
They look like psychos? Is that what they look like? They were vampires. Psychos do not explode when sunlight hits them. I don't give a fuck how crazy they are.
That shit kills me every time, man. Fucking George Clooney is so fucking funny. It doesn't matter how many times I see that movie, that shit cracks me up every fucking time. The first time I heard that, I bust out laughing so hard. So it really doesn't matter how many times I see that movie, it makes me laugh every time. So that has to be the one, man. Okay, so a few more questions and then I'm gonna wrap this bitch up and we'll get to music, because I can't keep going on and on, man. There's too many damn questions and a lot of them are repeats, so it's hard to filter them all out. You guys are crazy. There's so many of them. Thank you guys so much. And we'll do this again. So if your question doesn't get answered, sorry. We'll get to it, I promise. At some point, we'll do another show. Leanne McDougall asks, what is the first thing you notice about someone when you first meet them? That's a great question, actually. Their energy. The way they carry themselves. The vibe I get from them. Just everything. How they come across. And what I feel in their presence, I guess. Jocelyn Hicks asks, what compliment do people give you the most? I would have to definitely say probably something along the lines of, oh, you got such nice eyes. Like, everyone always compliments my eyes, so I think that would be the one, probably. I don't know what it is about blue eyes that people like so much that they constantly notice it, but they point it out to me all the time and are very complimentary about it, so maybe that would be it, I think. Carly J asks, what is your life motto? Don't fail yourself today. That's the one that sticks with me that I always stand by. Tom Lloyd asks, what food could you never give up? It's going to be either meat or ice cream, man. Sorry, y'all. Jennifer Larson, what is your favorite summer activity? Camping and barbecuing. But yeah, camping, you do all that great shit. Let's go to some music. Thank you guys so much for your questions. I got so much going on, I can't do more. Let's get to some music and I will catch your asses later. Thank you guys for making this so much fun. I love y'all, man.
You. Now it's a little late.
to get away from myself. Whoa. I really wish I could erase all the things I did. I really wish I had a path to recompense. I really wish I had a way to cleanse myself.
Rush the tunnel with a pound of weed. Cut the light on, you see it's Brick City in here. Blazing like Biggie passed us a simian year. Don't sleep, stay wide awoke. You dial Doc, not dial a joke. Crawl or you die of smoke. I keep it heated when the hawk is out. Seat it low, tie hope. Beat it when the dark is out. I'm outside of the line and I'm acting a fool. Like a 3 o'clock bully waiting after school. Punk, I've been in this line for hours. I even killed the time by helping my man pass out flyers. Now all I wanna do is get in where I fit in. Shake my ass with the baddest pigeon with a wig in. Jump, move, crash, smoke, break. Shake that ass, stay. Fuck you, yo. Pop a bear at the table and the porridge is poured. Since death is the label, I belong in the morgue. Thriller, I'm walking half dead at the sea now with bigger niggas from jail than the one on Green Mile. I'll huff and puff, blow the club down. I'll snuff a duck and head it uptown.
Yeah, that's right. We up in this joint now. Hey, yo, we get ready to take over. That's right. You got the mic. I'm about to turn tables. We gon' rock this joint, yo. If you got him in the club, freak.
Let's get dirty.
Say, let's get dirty.
Let's get dirty.
And you drunk up in the VIP.
Let's get dirty.
Say, let's get dirty.
Let's get dirty.
If you swinging from the club lights.
Let's get dirty.
Say, let's get dirty.
Let's get dirty.
And you like to start the club fight.
Let's get dirty.
Say, let's get dirty. Everybody wave your hands now.
Let's get dirty.
Say, let's get dirty.
Let's get dirty.
Everybody jump up and down.
Let's get dirty.
Say, let's get dirty.
Let's get dirty.
Everybody come to wild out.
Let's get dirty.
Say, let's get dirty.
Let's get dirty.
You a big dog, no doubt.
Let's get dirty.
Say, let's get dirty. Everybody wave your hands now.
Let's get dirty.
Say, let's get dirty.
Let's get dirty.
Everybody jump up and down.
Let's get dirty.
Say, let's get dirty.
Let's get dirty.
Everybody keep it going now.
Let's get dirty.
Say, let's get dirty.
Let's get dirty.
Just a little bit louder now.
Let's get dirty.
Say, let's get dirty. Come on, come on.
Let's get dirty. Let's get dirty.
Keep it going now.
This is DJ.
Say what?
On this motherfucker.
Yeah, it's 50 Cent, Young Buck, you make. We need the club jumping from beginning to the end, go shawty. We back up in this bitch again, we party. Harder than you can imagine, you can run with losers or run with winners and win.
I feel the tension when I walk in the club. G-Unit to the socks, bitches all on the thug. Come on, a Henny on the rocks and a bottle of bug. I don't need security, this whole nickel and nub. I came to ball with y'all, buy up the bar and all. So bitches call your hoes and niggas call your dog. I'm here to love your wife, keep her at home tonight. She might never come home again, nigga, I. Teeth, neck, wrist, all lights, my life like. Riding in Cashville and running all stoplights. Homie, is that real? I pray I keep living. My mama just had a dream of seeing me in prison. My daddy's a dope fiend and I don't really miss him. Ain't seen him in 10 years and a nigga still living. The same old tooth that we moved to a rhythm. 50 holler, get him, boy, you know I'm gon' get him.
I know you gon' let me shine and get mine. I know you gon' let me in with this nine. I know you gon' let me smoke up my weed. I know you gon' let me drink with no ID. I know you gon' let me shine and get mine. I know you gon' let me in with this nine. I know you gon' let me smoke up my weed. I know you gon' let me drink with no ID.
I know I'm sinning, but I'm winning at the same time. Took a couple shots from some niggas trying to take mine. I'm back on the block with a chopper and a tick nine. Niggas shooting cops in the hood, running stop signs. G-Unit, the gang, we just doing what the thugs do. GD, Vice Lords, Crips, and the Bloods too. Move, let me come through. It ain't a pair of handcuffs can hold me. I'm riding in the old school, listen to some oldies. My gold shining, them hoes crying, handling my 4-5, outlined in diamonds. Can't feel about the fly to Miami. Hoping Yeo watching Eminem perform at the Grammys. The reason niggas like Eric Benet probably can't stand me, cause I know money will make Halle Berry come out the planets. Bitch,
y'all niggas in trouble. They should've never let me in.
I know you gon' let me shine and get mine. I know you gon' let me in with this nine. I know you gon' let me smoke up my weed. I know you gon' let me drink with no ID. I know you gon' let me shine and get mine. I know you gon' let me in with this nine. I know you gon' let me smoke up my weed. I know you gon' let me drink with no ID. Yeah, I can make a bounce back. Teach him how to stunt, teach him how to count stacks. Know where your hood at, walk if you want to. Who 50 deep up in here, what you gon' do? Who want beef? I ain't come for no name calling. Don't be mad cause we is and you ain't ballin'. Get money is my motto for you broke folks. Can't spend your whole life paying on a car note. It's alright if you're still on the block, boy. See, I'm a cold young thug, not a hot boy.
You know I do this for the streets and my peeps that's behind bars. Soon as they come home, I'm going by my own cars, young boy.
I know you gon' let me shine and get mine. I know you gon' let me in with this nine. I know you gon' let me smoke up my weed. I know you gon' let me drink with no ID. I know you gon' let me shine and get mine. I know you gon' let me in with this nine. I know you gon' let me smoke up my weed. I know you gon' let me drink with no ID.
Bitch, I see you. Did you know I know you? Yeah, I know you. Last time I saw you, you was brewed up, booed up, ready for a new fuck. Last time you saw me, I was P.I. to the motherfucking MP. What? And lately I heard you's a broke bitch living in a lower class suburb. And lately the word is I live in a suburb and I don't fuck with birds. She used to pump on the block, sell a nigga rocks, bail a nigga out, but she tried to plot on a nigga. Vacant lot, one shot, bitch died, go figure. He used to pay this bitch, gave her lots of shit. Fuck's wrong with this nigga, man? He used to bring it through the hood, treat the bitch too fucking good, my opinion. We used to blaze with the bitch, faded off the lick, she X-rated the clip. This nigga bought braids for the bitch, Louis Vuitton kicks a trick on some suck shit. Meanwhile in the hood, she driving around good, this bitch thinks she in Hollywood. Meantime, she setting the nigga up, telling us where the stuff, she ready to get him stuck. What?
Thick guys, but she full of surprises, I swear this bitch is shady.
That's what I know.
Sex on her mind all the time, and you think that that's your baby.
You don't know.
You a good guy that's living a lie, but she told him where your safety.
That's what I know.
If you cool and she satisfied, how come that bitch just paged me?
You don't know. We had to ride on a nigga, watch him for the right time to get richer. We decided when the hit was, run up on him, 45 in the ribs. What? This nigga screamed like a bitch, shoulders where the shit hit a hell of a lick. But the bitch who told us about the bricks exposed us to the nigga, he knew that we'd come. But meanwhile in this hood, his niggas is suiting up, and Tim diluted up. Rims and new trucks, your man living it up. Then the van with no hub suddenly pulled up in the rough. Shot a nigga the fuck up, just my luck. The bitch got us both touches like a rush. The bitch who blushed and smoked blunts with us turned out to be nuts. Switched up, mixed up with the wrong slut. Got my frame zipped up in a bag, it's all bad. My niggas got my back, in fact, they caught on the ass, flossing in another nigga cab.
Thick guys, but she full of surprises, I swear this bitch is shady.
That's what I know.
Sex on her mind all the time, and you think that that's your baby.
You don't know.
You a good guy that's living a lie, but she told him where your safety.
That's what I know.
If you cool and she satisfied, how come that bitch just paged me?
You don't know.
In the radios down, so nervous my whole body shakes. The parking lot's full of people and they ready to see the preacher man. Time to open up for the main act, I guess that makes me a deacon. I promise that I won't let me down and check myself in the mirror one time. Say my prayer and then I sip the crown, light another smoke and step outside. Walk inside and take a look around as I try to remember all of my lines. Guess it's time for me to face the crowd and give the people my time. Johnny Cash.
Johnny Cash.
Like a window, I'm wearing my soul on my sleeve, but they look at me through a pinhole. All I see is this opportunity to see at least one of you in me, but I can't seem to win them over, so I swallow the humility. 15 minutes to hold them down, and I'm just wishing that it would fly by. It's like my whole world hits the ground. All I wanted to do was have a good time. Hold me under, but I will not drown. All I really know how to do is survive. Next time that I come to your town, I'll be the fucking headline. Johnny Cash.
Johnny Cash.
And I suppose I'm not supposed to be this rapper poking holes at stereotypes, or to write this juxtapose and flow to beats it shows. I hold the microphone and out me goes. These songs and quotables, call me nasty, say I stink, or hit the sink and hold your nose. Cause I'm about as convincible as a bum in stolen clothes to let go of those. I got dreams like fish got gills. I can't survive in this lake water without a deal, but I can build Noah's Ark without a power drill. Look at this crowd like it's a battlefield. Tell them my travels, my triumphs, my failures, my family loud and clear. Let them all judge, I don't care how they feel. Fuck it, what do I care? I'm my personal shrink. Throw my heart down on the ground, stomp it, use the blood for the ink. I'm used to purple and pink bruises, so thanks for the tools. It's just a brick for the mansion, another stitch in the pants of a Johnny Cash.
Johnny Cash.
Hello, this is Nerd Cage Live, and you're listening to Nerd Cage Live right here on Tattness Radio. If you like what you hear, be sure to subscribe to us over at youtube.com/nerdcagelive.
You're now about to witness the strength, oh yeah, of geek knowledge. Hello, welcome, that's right. Once again, you are trapped in Nerd Cage Live. This channel is a celebration of all things pop culture, including the best video game of each decade and the Xbox Series X. Please hit that like button. Please subscribe. Share this everywhere. I'm your co-host, Jay St. G, certified geek 7 days a week, coming to you live from yours truly, the land of the orange, Syracuse, New York. And Joseph on paper will be here shortly. He's running from work. But you guys know him. He's our moderator. He's our troll hammer. He's stronger than the DK Banana Santa. You can't stop it. You can't crop it. You can't top it. Like a B-52 bomber, he's gonna drop it. He's the Nerd Cage Live gaming prophet. Born from the atomic seed in the titanium womb, it's Joe from Fallen One Gaming. What's going on, dude?
Dude, what an epic stream we have for you guys tonight with Shaquille Oatmeal and Fisk Vegas.
How you gents doing?
Doing good, doing good. Thank you for having me.
Fisk.
You know what time it is.
Absolutely. Okay, I do have a message for Nerd Cage Nation. I'm gonna be serious for a moment here. I just want to thank everybody who entered the contest. We got a good amount of entries for tonight. We are going to give away the Xbox at the end of the stream, but I just want to say thank you to everybody who stuck by us through all the hard times, all the good times, the thick and thin, the lineup changes, you know, the stream delays, the gaming delays, you know, all the fuck-ups, all the laughs, everything. Seriously, we know who everybody is. Me and Joe, we read the comments. We're up on the Facebook group. We're up on the Twitter. We're up on the Discord. Thank you, everybody, for being there from the jump. And thank you. This Xbox giveaway is a gift to you guys. And if you don't win tonight, please don't get discouraged. We promise you there'll be more giveaways. The more you support us, the more you show up, the more people you bring in, the more we're going to be able to do more giveaways like this one tonight. So again, thank you to everybody. Thank you to our guests, Shaq and Fisk, for helping us do this giveaway tonight. We're really, really excited. We're really hoping that whoever wins tonight, that this Xbox will, like, I want to say change their life. I hope it makes them happier and yeah. And whatnot. You know, we're proud to give this away. We've never done a giveaway like this. So again, thank you very much. And real quick, if you haven't already, please get yourself a Nerd Cage Live t-shirt. Again, if you do not have the power and wisdom and courage to talk to women, or guys for that matter, get yourself a Triforce Nerd Cage Live gaming shirt. Oh my god, we got more. Check it out. It's too dangerous to go alone. Get this shirt as well. What do we have here? This is our top selling shirt here. The regular with the strength of geek knowledge on the back. Holy shit, guys. For those who like this website here, this is our second most selling shirt. Not for the kids, though. In celebration of Mortal Kombat 12, aka Mortal Kombat 1, and Brian Glenn coming next week, we got this Mortal Kombat arcade marquee. Oh, looks like Josh is here. We got the Mortal Kombat 1 Fatality shirt. We got the Mortal Kombat 2 Fatality shirt. We got the Mortal Kombat 3 Fatality shirt. For you kaiju nerds, we also got this epic legendary kaiju shirt. Oh my god. And for the fans of the MCU, for those who love the Guardians of the Galaxy, get this shirt. It doesn't matter whether if you're a skinny booty call or a fat fuck, we go from small all the way to 5XL. Big or small, we love them all. Any size, any color, get yourself a shirt. The money, part of that proceeds goes to us. And come on, they look great, they smell great, they make you look, they fit awesome. Be sure to get yourself a Nerd Cage Live shirt. All right, so we have these two fantastical guests. Please subscribe to them. The links are in the description. And we're let me bring in Josh, because Josh is here. Hold on, let me full screen everybody here. Let me get Josh in. And then once Josh is in, Shaq, I want you to go ahead and plug whatever you want to plug and introduce yourself for those who don't know who you are and stuff. So hang on here. I just got to fix this Zoom call. Let me move Joe to the waiting room. And
there we go.
I think we are good here. Just waiting for Josh to turn his camera on. All right. Shaq, go ahead, man. Tell everybody what you do.
Hey, man, this isn't about me. This is about a celebration of you guys.
So
I'm going to be brief. Just if you like what I say, you've seen me on some previous shows, just go check the links in the description, and you'll find out more then. Let's make it about Nerd Cage Live today. Let's celebrate these guys and what they've accomplished in this 3 years you mentioned.
Yes, 3 years. Years yesterday.
Go and check my stuff in the description if you're interested, if you're so inclined. Love to have you.
All right, we appreciate that. Fist Vegas, everybody should know who you are, but go ahead. Tell everybody what you do. Anything you want to promote, the floor is yours, buddy.
What's good, fellas? This is the hardest voice of sports, Fist Vegas. You understand me? Go over to my channel, General Fist. Go over to my channel, Fist Vegas Blue. Hit the like button, hit that sub button, and hit the notification bell. You understand me? Subscribe to my channels, join this Fist Unit Army, and get Fist Unit tough. Okay? The Fist Unit Army wants you. So go recruit. Go enlist. I'm not playing with y'all. Just because we're on Nerd Cage don't mean I won't come through your screen like Freddy Krueger and do you bodily harm, but my sub count don't go up. All right.
Yeah, and get up on you. You guys want a good laugh,
check out Fist Vegas' streams and his podcast. My God, some of the shit that comes out of your mouth, Fisk. I'll be laughing for days, man. If you guys want a good laugh, telling you, Fist Vegas. And let me tell you something, for you young men out there, you 16, 17, 18, 19, 20-year-olds out there, man, if you want some good, manly advice from a man who's seen it all, you're going to get some gold nuggets from Fist Vegas every now and then, let me tell you.
I'm trying to save y'all. You know what I'm saying? Every now and again, I gotta give y'all the game, give y'all some chips. I don't give y'all too much though, because I don't want to get shadow banned. You know what I'm saying? YouTube don't like when the algorithm don't like when men teach men how to be men. So, you know, I ain't gonna give you too much, but I'm gonna get you right. You know what I'm saying? Once a week, I might drop a gem or two, help you get a girl, help you, you know what I'm saying, make some money. You know, I do what I can.
Hey man, like I said, if I was like a young teenager, it would be, you know, you are a great role model, you know? We need more role models like Fist. So, again, what's really cool is not only that Fist is, like, a sports enthusiast, but may not everybody knows, he's just as much of a nerd as we are. And this is going to be a fun discussion. Josh of On Paper is here. Josh, anything you want to promote, man, the floor is yours, buddy.
Nah, I'm good. What? Can you hear me? Everything's
yes,
good?
Yes, everything's good. Everything's good, man. Good. You look electrifying, man. We're excited to have you back.
Let's get into it, brother. Let's do it.
Perfect timing. All right. Joe, before we get started, let everybody know what's going on tomorrow. And just coming off the Mortal Kombat 12 announcement, Mortal Kombat 1 announcement today. Joe, let them know what's going on tomorrow.
Yes, tomorrow we go back to Mortal Kombat 11 Aftermath.
Abso-friggin-lutely. And Tuesday, right?
Yes, Tuesday we go back to Metroid Prime Remastered.
And of course, in preparation for, what, Joe, let them know what's going on next Thursday.
Yes, next Thursday, Brian Glynn, the original Shao Kahn himself, will grace us with his presence.
Yes.
So get your questions ready.
Yes, so next Thursday, the original Shao Kahn will be here for a live Q&A. Be there, have your questions ready. We're excited. Again, with Mortal Kombat 12 being announced today, timing couldn't have been any better. And finally, if you haven't already, please check out Joe and I unbox Zelda Tears of the Kingdom Collector's Edition for your viewing pleasure. All right. Cool. We're ready. Oh, Joe, plug in social media and we'll get started with the discussion.
All right. If you want to get us on Twitter or Instagram, both handles are @nerd_cage. Our link to our Discord is in the description, so become a member there as well. And our Facebook discussion group that is Nerd Cage Nation. We love everything you guys put up there. No spoilers, no politics, and for God's sakes, keep it civil.
Well said, well said. So for those who are not familiar with this format, if you guys are coming from the Round 1 podcast, if you're coming from Fist Vegas, or if you're here for the Xbox giveaway, what we're going to do tonight is we're going to go around in a circle. We're going to each name one video game, what we think is the best video game of each decade, and after that person names their game, they're going to defend it, and then we're all going to either agree or argue or otherwise, and then we're on to the next person. Then once we make a full circle, we're going to go on to the next decade. So 80s, 90s, 2000s, 2010s. So we're going to start with Shaq to Fisk to Josh to Joe and then to me. So all right, so without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, the best video game of each decade started with the 80s. So Shaq, what do you think is the best video game of the 1980s? The floor is yours, buddy.
There's so many to choose from. But I think the most influential, the most impactful, and one of the greatest games of that entire decade is the original Super Mario Brothers.
Excellent pick, excellent pick. I am not gonna knock that. I don't know how you guys feel, but I would say the main argument for that one, it's the video game that saved the video game industry. So anybody want to debunk that, or anybody think, what do you guys think?
Well, I just have a question, and that's what if we have the exact same answer? Because that's the case. That's the case.
Yeah.
Because that was my pick.
Yeah, I feel like a lot of these might be the same.
No, I have a couple that might be that might differ.
Beginning the latter years.
But this one is it's kind of hard to pick one that isn't Mario Brothers.
Yeah.
Because I was thinking about it, I was gonna say like Tetris or one of those, but
yeah,
I can't, because Mario Brothers is so much more important, and I see the look on Jay's face.
We're forgetting the 70s, man. We're forgetting Pong, Space Invaders.
I think that was 78, but they were impactful in the 80s.
Yeah.
Oh, we're talking about the 70s? No, we're just talking about
the 80s.
We're starting with the 80s, because video games is barely a thing in the 70s. Miss Vegas, are you going to body somebody?
Oh, you know I got the fist in the typewriter on deck at all times. Check this out, right? Mm-hmm. I'm going to keep this simple. When I think of the 80s, I got to think of video games that people who don't like video games played. So I'm going to go with Pac-Man, because I remember being a kid and my aunts and uncles would play Pac-Man. They don't like video games, but they sat down and played Pac-Man. I go to the laundromat, I see Pac-Man. I go to the corner store, I see Pac-Man. I ain't never seen no Mario when I went to get the cold, cuz I never saw Mario when I went to do the laundry. But Miss Pac-Man was everywhere. Womp, 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 womp. Everybody wanted to womp, womp, womp like Pac-Man. I gotta go with Miss Pac-Man. Miss Pac-Man was lit. Going through, seeing the different color boards and... going with Pac-Man.
I'm loving the chat right now. They're throwing so many names out there.
Shout out to all the fat, overweight plumbers out there who want to be like Mario, though. He was real inspirational.
And his brother. Shout out to my mom. Lisa, love you. The queen of Pac-Man. Like, I used to watch her, because she's I have a young mother, so I used to watch her in the arcade, like, tear it up, and I was like, man, I wish I could be as good as her.
Yes, women love Pac-Man.
She still got it. Like, we were playing, like, years ago.
Pac-Man.
Yeah. Hell yeah.
All right, Josh, we already know your pick, but is there anything you want to add to the argument and strengthen
it? Well, just to ape off what you said, because you'd mentioned the 70s, after E.T. and all the failure that had happened, where I guess I wasn't even alive back then, but video game, I'm not even that old. Damn, dude. So I missed all the failure of video games. I probably wouldn't have known about, you know, any video games. I wouldn't be playing Nintendo if it wasn't for Mario Brothers or any of that. Yeah. You know what I mean? So the fact that it did save the industry that was dying is key. I give a props to both, probably Pac-Man and Mario Brothers for that.
Joe, you're being a lot of deserving games. I'm quiet right now, so I got.
I was gathering my thoughts.
Okay,
but dude, I can respect the hell out of Pac-Man, but I do have to say that Super Mario Brothers was quite literally what brought video games home for everyone.
Okay.
This was the first biggest home console game that we had to date, and it's still alive today. It just spawned one of the highest grossing movies, so I have to give it to Mario.
I would say Pac-Man started in the arcade, right? I've seen part of the documentary of that. Okay. All right, so maybe that spawned the arcade scene, you know what I mean? Maybe that got it a little bit more hyped.
Okay. I gotta step in here because I'm seeing some smart asses in the chat. I'm with Chris Vegas here, okay? I had two choices. I was either going with the video game that saved video games or the game that put video games and put arcades on the map, and it was Pac-Man. And you know what? I want to know something, guys? The reason why I was conceived by my parents was Pac-Man. Pac-Man was everything in the early 80s, all right?
Ladies love Pac-Man, man.
Listen, Pac-Man crawled and munched so Mario could run, okay? It's Pac-Man. Pac-Man is the best game of the 80s.
If we're going on conception, you're going to be proud of this because I was conceived because of Zelda.
Hold on, I got a sound effect for you, Joe. If Joe's parents are in here, that was the noise that was made when the atomic seed went into the titanium womb.
Nice.
Yo, I'm telling you, Pac-Man. I It was hard. It was either Mario or Pac-Man. I went with Pac-Man.
No, so, nobody will hate either of those. You can't hate on either of those. When we get to the 90s and 2000s, that's what we'll save the hate for.
Okay, so that being said, are we ready to move on to the 90s?
Yes, I do have a disclaimer for everybody, though. The my picks are based on extreme game changers.
Okay.
Mine too. Same thing. Yeah.
Okay. Well, yeah. I'm loving what the chat's saying, and we have we got three guys here for Mario and two guys here for Pac-Man and Miss Pac-Man. So we got two Pac-Mans and three Mario. So there you go.
Miss Pac-Man and Pac-Man, they're the same game.
It's
Come
the
on.
Same Are game.
They? Yeah, yeah. Just Pac-Man. Just fucking, you know, whatever. Junior, it's the one. It's the same shit, yeah.
I know there was a difference.
No, it's not.
Miss Pac-Man, the mazes changed. Pac-Man
didn't change. Oh, I don't know. Okay, I'm an expert.
Yeah. Like I said, I come from a Pac-Man family, so.
Okay.
All right, so now we're moving on to what I think was the best decade across everything. The 90s was like the best time for music, the best time for movies, the best time for video games, the best time for TV shows and cartoons. And
it was our renaissance.
It was, the 90s, man. The 90s just hit different. That being said, Shaquille Oatmeal of the Round 1 Podcast, what is your pick of the best video game of the 1990s?
This was tough. I had like five games that I wanted to mention, because I think they were all really important to pushing the genre forward, especially in the 90s, throughout the 90s. But I think the best game of the 90s was probably Final Fantasy VII, I would have to say.
Oh, I love it. I love it.
It made JRPGs kind of popular in the West. Mm. It sold a lot of PlayStations. People who never played JRPGs or even RPGs in general were buying PlayStations and playing Final Fantasy VII. It was like a phenomenon for the time that it came out. It's to this day, I think, still one of the best games ever made.
Woo!
But there's a lot of deserving candidates of the 90s.
man, that's a good pick. Nine, I can't argue that. That's definitely not my pick, but I can't argue that. I don't know how everybody else feels.
I was never a Final Fantasy fan. I'm sorry. I remember on PS2, what was it, Final Fantasy X? It came out like 2001, and they commercial played like all freaking day.
Yeah.
The dang old Final Fantasy. Listen, I need to be able to put my work in manually, like Devil May Cry and God of War. I need to be able to manually put my work in. Me pressing a button and watching them do something,
And turn-based isn't for everybody.
Yeah, I can get into
it. It initially wasn't, but now in my adult years, I'm catching up and I'm getting more a little into turn-based. And, we've gone back and forth about Final Fantasy on the show, how maybe it didn't age graphically, but you know what I mean? It's so important for the PlayStation's life cycle, even though I think there were other PlayStation games that were more important to launch it, but yeah.
Yeah, I'm kind of gonna echo what Josh said. Like, it's not a bad pick. I just don't think, because of JRPGs and like turn-based RPGs, it's not for everyone, which is why I wouldn't have picked it. But I totally understand where Shaq's coming from. But it didn't even cross my mind. It's like, when I think 90s, I don't exactly think Final Fantasy. That's just me. Shaq, don't like execute me for that.
Yeah. However, I know people. Some people don't like turn-based games, but the game itself was masterful in its story. And if you are willing to give it another chance, I say play the remake, because they have free-flow combat in that rather than turn-based combat.
Okay. All right, Fist Vegas, man. What do you got for the best game of the 1990s? And I know you're a diehard 90s person, too.
All right, so here's the deal. I'm gonna give my honorable mention to Metal Gear Solid 1, okay, on PS1, because when we had to unplug the controller to beat Psycho Mantis, that was different. I mean, that was legendary. That really was. But You're gonna get a trend from me. I'm not gonna pick any single player games as the best game of the decade.
Okay.
I feel like if you can't enjoy with people, it can't be the best game. So I had a hard choice, and I'm not gonna go GoldenEye. I was gonna go GoldenEye.
Oh, okay.
And I was gonna go GoldenEye, but about 5 minutes ago, I changed my mind.
Okay.
Because this Jay just reminded me how lit the '90s was, and I'm like, you know what? The only thing I cared about in the '90s was the NWO. The only thing I cared about in the '90s was telling people to know their role and shut their mouth.
Okay.
That's all I cared about.
All right.
So the best game of the '90s is WCW NWO Revenge on the N64.
What?
Okay.
What?
You got four controllers. You got your four homeboys at the crib, and we got busy. That's what we did. We used to play wrestling all night long. We used to play the Fatal Four Ways. We used to have tag team matches. That's what we did on the weekends. Me and the boys, we got together and we played WCW, Hulk Hogan, Kevin Nash, freaking my man Disco Inferno with the knockoff Stone Cold Stone.
Scott, if you are in the chat, I will never forget your bachelor party. We played that game at your bachelor party.
Yes. Them were the good old days. Now, granted, the best one was No Mercy, but that's in the 2000s. But
okay.
For the 90s, you know what I'm saying? 90s, we got to go with WCW, NWO Revenge. That game, I could still play that game. If I had an N64 right now, bad graphics and all, I will still play that game.
Wow, dude, I'm loving these picks. Both of these picks so far just came out of left field. I don't know. So what do you guys think about Joe? You're a wrestling guy. I want to hear your thoughts. Joe, what do you got?
It was a very impactful game. I will give it that. I just wasn't super into wrestling until No Mercy came out. So
No Mercy was legendary. Oh,
it was.
See, I was more of a WWF guy, so for me, D-Generation X, I got Warzone first. That being said,
Warzone.
I'm going to agree with Fisk, even though my nostalgia with... Well, not totally, because I didn't...
Not totally.
But, you know, as far as for wrestling games, yeah. I also had a... what the hell? Was it Mayhem? That came later, too. But, I think that the THQ came and destroyed the Warzones and the Acclaim games. It just had better feel, more customization, you know, and... I talked about this not too long ago about games that had aged well. We talked about like those old wrestling games. I love them, you know. Yeah,
dude, I love it. I love it. I love it. All right. That being said, Josh, what's your pick for the 90s?
Oh, that's it. But Jay, what are you? You're.
I mean, like I said, that was just out of left field. I mean.
All right, well, I have one. I have one. If you want me to change it, I'll change it. But I have one way out of, like, not even in the same stadium. It's not even in the stadium.
I think we're all going to have different picks here.
Throw it on us.
I have to. You know, I have to say 1993, a game that changed my life, even though I wasn't playing back then. It took me a little while. Magic the Gathering. To me, Magic the Gathering.
Go back to the roots.
Absolutely. I don't know if that's fair. I know, you know, it's card games, spawned other video games, but talk about changing a genre and setting up, you know, the building blocks for what became Yu-Gi-Oh, Pokemon, everything else. Magic the Gathering to me is the best game I've ever played in my life. So since that's the game of the 90s, that's what I'd pick. Unless you want me to change it to a video game.
What's your video game?
I would say Tomb Raider. Yeah. Oh. I would say Tomb Raider was more important to the PlayStation than... Yeah, without a doubt. Because how many... Wow. I think more PlayStations were sold on the back of on the chest of Lara Croft
I remember, like, Lara Croft being, like, the hottest shit ever. Like, yo...
That was why I bought a PlayStation. I'm not going to lie. But it was back then. And obviously with what she came, you know, the whole era. But I'm not against, you know, Final Fantasy either, though. You know, I mean, these are all great picks. But I think Tomb Raider is just a little bit more important.
My only thing about my counter argument to you, Josh,
okay,
was Lara Croft the reason? I would argue Crash Bandicoot was the game, because Crash Bandicoot was out there with his suit and his megaphone talking shit to Nintendo. Yeah. I mean, wasn't Lara Croft? I mean, I could argue
that.
Yeah,
I think you're preaching in the wrong choir, because I didn't give a shit about Crash. I still don't really like Crash Bandicoot.
But I will say Lara Croft, I think, I mean, she wasn't the first. I mean, Samus will always be like the queen of like female protagonists, because she kicked it off. But Lara Croft did take it to the next level, and she did kind of, you know, we were all like adolescent 13-year-olds.
I was gonna say
Joe's memory card. Yes, the Lara Croft memory card.
Last time I did get away with throwing the monkey wrench in. I threw in the Virtual Boy or whatever into our game. So I was like, oh, let me see if I can throw magic in there. But I don't know.
No, I understand your argument, Josh. I just feel like it was Crash Bandicoot if you're going to pick any place. Okay, you got everyone else is quiet. What do you guys think about Josh's pick?
I agree. Tomb Raider was a very influential thing back then. You know, I mean, it kind of still is in its own way. But, you know, it's the first time we got pixelated nudity, pretty much, for the most part.
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah, I'm fine
with it, too.
Okay, okay. Joe of Fallen 1 Gaming. I think I already know what your pick is, but I want to hear it.
Everybody knows me so well. I have to go back to my roots on this, and I have to give it to the OG Resident Evil.
Why am I not surprised?
Oh, yeah. I was going to guess. If you would have put money
that out. Changed the game forever. And started survival horror, I have to give it to that. Bad voice acting and all.
I'm going to say this, though, Joe. I don't think the 90s was the best decade for Resident Evil. I mean, it may have kicked it off, but you could argue...
Well, it does have two of them. It was really hard for me not to say two.
Yeah.
But I do have to... The OG started it, so I had to go with the OG.
That's fair, but again, that's interesting, because we have... three people picking PlayStation games. We got, you know, we got Shaq with Final Fantasy VII, Josh with Tomb Raider, and Joe with Resident Evil. So we got three PlayStation games. 32-bit era. All right, what do you guys think about Resident Evil?
I was gonna pick a computer game, but
Ultima or some shit. What was it, in the 90s? I'm sorry, Matt. Say your computer game. I know. That is true.
I was
going to pick Half-Life.
Oh, I thought you were going to say... Doom.
It was Half-Life
Doom,
or Doom.
Doom. No, Doom, definitely. Half-Life, I don't know. They might give a shit about that back then. Doom, definitely, though. Doom, like, that's a good choice, too. Wow.
Okay. All right, I guess I'll make my pick. Okay, so I thought about this long hard. This should come to no surprise to anybody. I actually was going to pick Doom. I almost did pick Doom.
Oh.
I almost did pick Doom. Solely for the reason that it kickstarted the first-person genre, or you could argue Wolfenstein, but I'm not gonna pick Doom, and you guys are gonna kill me because I didn't pick Mario for the 80s, but my pick for the 90s is Super Mario World.
Oh, Super Mario World.
Now here's why.
Okay.
I feel like even though Super Mario Bros. In the 80s kickstarted. It saved the video game industry in the 80s, and it kickstarted the side-scrolling genre to the next level. But Super Mario World perfected it and brought us to 16-bit era, which is, I think, the best era of video games ever. So that being said, the best game of the 90s is Super Mario World, and Super Mario World had a reign. That game dominated for half of the decade. That game dominated the Super Nintendo.
Hold on, time out. What's up, Fisk? I intentionally left this game off thinking Jay was going to go there, but he didn't do it. So, you mean to tell me we got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 OGs on the panel right now?
Yeah.
And not one Street Fighter Mortal Kombat mentioned for the best game in the 90s? No Street Fighter 2 or Mortal
Kombat. I thought Jay was going to go in that direction.
Listen, wow.
I just knew Jay was going to say
that. I mean,
your card is revoked.
I'm the resident Renaissance fighting game player. I play all the Guilty Gear, Street Fighter. I love it, but I'm trying to be unbiased with this a little bit.
That's just it. I'm trying to be unbiased too. And
so, and fighting games are niche, and I'm well aware of it.
Okay, if
we
were talking best fighting game of the 90s, without a doubt, I probably would have picked Mortal Kombat 2 or
Killer Instinct. Pick Street Fighter 2.
Oh, no.
It's all
right. Street Fighter?
Yeah, I would have picked Street Fighter 2 because I'm a Street Fighter
2. I was going Street Fighter Alpha 3. Alpha 3 was the best one. Street Fighter Alpha 3 on PS2.
Okay, no, okay. PS1. I just, but you got to understand, again, I know it's a side-scroller game, but again, Super Mario World perfected it. It's the best Mario game ever made. And like I said, it kickstarted the Super Nintendo. And like I said, it rained for half the decade. It wasn't until the PlayStation... It really wasn't, like I said, it wasn't until when the PlayStation came out where people shifted. But I'm telling you, it was Super Mario, I'm telling you, Super Mario World is arguably the best Mario game of all time. And if you look at the best video game list from all the websites, Super Mario World is up there in like the top 10.
I'm surprised. I thought you were going to say 64.
No, no. Oh, yeah.
Okay,
was nowhere near the gem that Super Mario World is.
Okay.
Super Mario World is aged beautifully. I'm telling you, that's my pick. Mention.
One more honorable mention.
Yes.
I feel guilty if we don't bring it up.
Okay.
Shout out to Sonic the Hedgehog. That saves
you. Oh, yeah.
Shout out to Sonic.
All right, I hate Sonic, and I've said this many times. I hate the character Sonic. I hate the game Sonic. I hate the movie Sonic.
I hate the Sonic.
Because he's the blue Mario. It's like, we need to shove somebody in there, and you know, for the kids.
Yeah, the rings and everything. What's a little trash?
Oh, my God. I already said this. If I could go back in time, I'd beg my mom for a Super Nintendo instead of a Sega.
Oh, wow.
It sucks.
I see where Fisk is coming from. I just feel like Super Mario World just, like, I don't think any of the first three Sonic, as great as the first three Sonic games were, they don't come close to Super Mario World. Joe, did we not have the time of our life playing it on Twitch a couple years ago?
We did.
I just want to say a lot of us had PlayStation games because in the 90s, like, PlayStation was the most important console to get us to that next generation. Not really money. Yeah. I didn't have a Sega Saturn. I had a Dreamcast, but compared to...
Yeah, but Dreamcast came at the tail end of the decade, so I...
That was the end of the decade, right? Yeah,
but so we got three PlayStation games, a Super Nintendo, and a Nintendo 64 game. So...
Yeah.
I
can see the trend here, guys. Like, even though we all had different games, but we had three PlayStation games. So, again, this is fun. This is fun.
I got to correct myself. I made a mistake. I said the best fighting game of the 2000s was Alpha 3. I'm wrong. The best fighting game of the 2000s was actually Tekken 3. Shout out to Tekken 3.
Sure, Tekken 3 is good.
Dude, I'm loving the chat here. Like, Tekken wow. You guys are having good ones. And Zoomzilla, Super Metroid's my favorite video game of all time. But if I'm being unbiased, I just feel like... And Fist said it best. He's like, I got to pick a two-player game. So, that's like I said, Super Mario World is a great two-player game. And, like, again, every Mario game that's come out since, and I'm talking 2D and 3D, I just feel like... You know, Super Mario World was just the next level. So now I feel like this next decade, 2000s, I think is going to be the most difficult. And I had to think, long and hard I changed my mind several times on this one. So I can't wait to see what everybody's pick is for the 2000s here. Whoa, we're flying, by the way. So that being said, Shaq, kick it off. What was the best game of the 2000s?
This was also a hard choice. I have a bunch of games written down on this list, but I think I'm going to go with my personal favorite of this bunch of games that I think was the most important series of the 2000s.
Okay.
And my favorite game in that series was Grand Theft Auto Vice City.
Wow!
Ooh!
I think the Grand Theft Auto series is... one of the most popular series, if not the most popular series, probably in gaming right now.
I was gonna say San Andreas. San Andreas to me was the shit. I mean, was that 2000s though?
Yeah, that was 2004. Yeah. San Andreas. I still got the original.
Yeah.
I I can't argue that. My only argument to Shaq would be, okay, are you sure it was Vice City? Because I would argue the Grand Theft Auto 3. I would argue Grand Theft Auto 3 over Vice City.
I think Grand Theft Auto 3 started it, but there was a lot of things, like, in terms of, like, the... You couldn't control the camera. The camera was, like, almost like a fixed camera. There was a silent protagonist. Like, there was... Yeah. It was still, like, very, like, primitive with, like, its controls and things like that. And I feel like Vice City is where it, like, kind of figured it out, and it was like, okay, this is what we need to do. And then... San Andreas, like, took all that stuff that Vice City perfected and then, like, did it with, like, a whole different lens.
Yeah, I don't, I'm not hating on Vice City. I like Vice City, too. I'm just saying, you know.
To be fair, 3 was the first time they got around from the... They got away from the top-down view.
Yeah, top-down, yeah.
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 My gun was very loud. My gun was very loud in 3. I take offense to you saying he was silent. That gun spoke by you.
All right, Fisk, what's your pick?
Oh, this is easy. This was the easiest one I had.
Really?
I didn't even have to think about this. This is the greatest multiplayer game I've ever played.
I know exactly what you're going to say.
And I have Gears a feeling like I'm
wow.
Gears of War 1. That was the funnest 2 years of my life.
Never mind.
Okay.
The greatest multiplayer shooter ever. The first Gears of War. You can't replicate that. It was the perfect combination of tactical team play, but one-on-one skill. Because remember, it was 4v4, and you had to kill everybody one by one each round. So you could be down to like 1v4, 3v1, and you could be tactical where you picked your opponent off.
And no respawn.
There was no respawn. That's the It was round based. It was round by round. And each round you had to kill all 4 people. It was different, and it was so 1v1 based, but it was tactical team play at the same time. It was beautiful, and it just some of the greatest gaming memories of my life was from 06 to 08, just being my junior year, 06, I was working at it was EB, because I don't think GameStop had bought EB yet, so it was still called EB. And I remember getting a game. I still have friends to this day I met on freaking Gears of War 1, man. And
wow.
That was just the game, man. 16-16 Ravendale, going to Gridlock, going to Tyrus Station, getting a torque bug. I mean, the sniper, down to people with the sniper.
Everybody rush boom.
Yes, everybody rush boom. Yes, like those were the days. Like, I remember, like, you always had to have a good sniper on your team. Nothing beat having a good sniper, getting an active reload down in the guy so the crew could go gangbang him or whatnot. You know what I'm saying? As the ultimate disrespect. Gears of War was very disrespectful. Every great multiplayer game has to be disrespectful. It was very disrespectful. I miss it.
I thought you were going to say Modern Warfare 2.
No, Call of Duty. See, here's the thing with Call of Duty, right? It doesn't have the same... what I liked about Gears of War, this and no other shooters replicate, it's that one-on-one, I'm that guy feel of invincibility. Like, these Modern Warfares and stuff like that, it's too much action. It's not enough strategy.
It was intimate.
It was, yes. Gears of War was very intimate. And it's just the way you moved in Gears of War. And you had to listen to things because you could hear the locusts when they ran. So you had to pay attention. It was just it was one of a kind. And I feel like when they made Gears of War 2, they tried to be more like a Call of Duty or a Halo.
Yeah, you are exactly right. I was so let down. Gears of War 2, in my opinion, had the best campaign, but I hate it when they changed the multiplayer.
They killed it, and I was like, one of the greatest games of my life got ruined because they wanted to copy Halo. I'm like, no, let Halo be Halo.
You're exactly right.
That was such a letdown. At least Gears of War 3 kind of went back to it, but it was never the same after Gears of War 1.
Facts.
Yes. No, I can't argue. I mean, you could argue Call of Duty, but that's a good pick, Fist, because that's actually one of my favorite games ever. It's actually in my top 20 favorite games of all time, and like, oh man. Actually, no, it's my top 10, actually. It's my top 10. But like, yeah, I mean, you make a good point, and I can understand where you're coming from. That time where we were going with those one-on-ones, you know, it did hit different. I just don't.
That was the only
shooter. My only argument to you would just be like, I don't know if that was pop culturally as impactful as other multiplayer games out there around that time.
Yeah,
that's not saying. That's not saying it wasn't the best. It's just, I'm just saying, as far as if I'm looking at it from the outside looking in, you could argue there's a lot of other games that you know, like Halo 2, Call of Duty, etc.
Yeah, but that's the thing, Jake. They ruined the second one. Notice you said Halo 2. They ruined it. If Gears of War 2 would have just built upon Gears of War 1, it would have had that impact.
Yeah.
But they ruined Gears of War 2. Gears of War 2 was supposed to be the one they took it to the next level and had the impact like a Halo 2 did.
But are you talking about story-wise or mechanics-wise?
No, it's just the format.
Okay.
It's the game format.
Okay.
Yeah, that round base kill all four of your opponents thing. It can't be topped then because it was so intimate and it required a different kind of skill.
You said that it was multiplayer that you played. You didn't go through the campaign though, or you didn't give a shit.
I mean, I beat the campaign on the first one because you know back in the days you wanted. What did Xbox have? Gamer Score or something like that?
Yeah.
And everybody took pride in getting achievements and everything?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so I did beat the campaign, but...
Yeah.
You didn't give a shit. You weren't invested in the story. Like.
I ain't give a damn. Give me the achievements. And I was good. I just wanted to get my achievements. After we got the achievements, it was back to campaign. I mean, back to multiplayer. Yeah.
All right. Well said. So, Josh, go ahead. Your pick for the best game of the 2000s.
I just want to say something about that. Yeah, I don't think that people gave a shit about stories like that until, like, later on. Like, you know, like the Halo, like the lore. Maybe I'm wrong. But my pick, though, is a game that changed people's lives, people's souls. You know, I watched people's lives fall apart playing this game. But mine didn't because I stopped playing after I reached level 45. World of Warcraft is.
I knew someone was going to pick it.
Well, it has to be picked because it's just. You want to talk about a genre changing, genre flipping game that literally, like, you know, defined like the decade for a lot of people. And I know a lot of people that would agree. I remember going out there to the Burning Crusade release, midnight, seeing like the line all the way to the back, people camping out way into so that they can play World of Warcraft for another 12, 15 hours, 16 hours of their life, you know? And, I think some people died playing World of Warcraft, like coffee shops. Isn't there a story about that? You know, so
they played too long.
I gave up. I was like, you know what? This is an entire lifestyle. I like the game. I gotta move on. I gotta go do something else with my life. But definitely the best game of the decade.
Okay, I have no argument to that because I knew someone here was gonna pick that game.
Yeah,
and I mean you got the South Park. You got Henry Cavill. Almost missing the phone call for Superman because of World of Warcraft. You got like celebrities and porn stars all playing World of Warcraft. You got
My former friend who shall remain nameless. The reason why I said something about soul, like losing your soul. This kid, who again shall remain nameless, played World of Warcraft so much that he like was in the fetal position with his rosary beads. I remember I went to his house and I might have been making this up. He was in the fetal position with his rosary beads praying and like, I have to quit playing this game.
I mean, South Park nailed it. Like, they all got fat and they're pooping on their computer chairs. You know,
totally.
I get it. I have no argument here. I literally have no argument. Unless anyone else wants to argue, I have no argument for that.
I mean, we can talk about the mechanics too. Shaq and I, because we both played it, but
yeah,
the actual game is like really, really good too.
Oh yeah, it's great.
Yeah.
Right. It's easy to see why people got addicted to it. Supplement to that.
Shaq, man. Shaq, tell him about it. Tell him about it, brother.
It's just easy to see why people got addicted to it, you know, the from like every aspect of the game, the whole like PvE, the questing, everything. Like, you could just get lost in the world, and like, you'd see so much like funny, stupid stuff happening on there when you'd go into like big servers and stuff.
Yeah,
it was definitely a great game.
You pick your poison. Do you want to do 2v2? Do you want to go on raids? Do you want to level up your guy? Like, you, there's so many things to do. Joe, you weren't a World of Warcraft guy?
No.
No, he stayed away. Fisk?
Never played.
All right, man. You guys are smart.
Yeah, I was going to say, I can't picture Fisk. This doesn't roll like that.
The most addictive single-player game I played in the 2000s would have been one of Elder Scrolls, probably like Oblivion or something.
Yeah, Morrowind was my second choice. Morrowind or Oblivion was my second choice.
All right.
Yo, shout out to those games, by the way. I don't know. Now that I look back on it, I used to play Oblivion for like 8 hours. It felt like 30 minutes. And going around doing sneaky missions for thieves and shit. Clapping random people, trying to going back to caves to get rewards and shit. Shout out to Oblivion. That man was lit.
Okay. Joe, your pick for the best game of the 2000s.
So I had to go with this because it's the only game that's been able to dethrone and take me away from PlayStation. It's the reason I bought an Xbox. And it's the game that changed multiplayer forever. Well, actually, I can't say that. It started Xbox Live, we'll say that. And I know you're going to think I'm saying Halo 2. I'm actually saying the original Halo Combat Evolved. Just because of the fact that, you know, that game, when it first came out, was so impactful and had such a compelling story, and just its Master Chief's debut, it no holds barred.
And he's trying to promote a giveaway tonight.
Exactly.
Listen, I'm going to say this, though. I will say this. Do we, to add to Joe's argument here, do we have Xbox today if we didn't have Halo?
No.
He's
not Mario or Microsoft. No.
I was going to say he's a Lara Croft of same thing, you know, like the poster child.
So Joe's got a good point. Like it defined an entire game console.
Yeah, easily.
So that's a good argument. And I have no counter argument.
PS2.
I would counter argument Halo 2. If anything, I'd counter argument Halo 2.
I think Halo 2 is superior. I'll agree with that. But I did have to give it to Halo for putting it on the map.
I challenge anybody else here to name an Xbox game that it was even close, like, to put it on the map. Like, that was, oh, yeah, you had Halo and, like, I don't even know. I can't
Halo
even think
was
of one.
A phenomenon.
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, it was playing stupid SOCOM or play Halo. It wasn't close. Because on PS2, that was SOCOM. It's like, yo, we not rocking with this. We not rocking with SOCOM, man.
Man, we all went in different directions. I mean, we had two Xbox games, and then we got a Grand Theft Auto and World of Warcraft. So, here's where I come in. And again, I'm not necessarily a fan of this game. I mean, I was, but I tapped out real quick. And it needs to be said. Now, I feel like you're gonna see a weird trend here. Okay, so obviously I picked Pac-Man in the 80s. I didn't pick Mario, but I picked Super Mario World in the 90s over Doom. In this same kind of realm here where, yes, Doom really kickstarted the first-person shooter, and then I feel like GoldenEye was like the next step. But the next step after that, that perfected modern-day shooting, and it's still being, it's Call of Duty 4. Call of Duty 4 changed everything. Call of Duty 4 came out of nowhere. After Call of Duty 1, 2, and 3 was World War II, they went to the Modern Warfare. Call of Duty 4, Modern Warfare, and it was online play. And yes, I think Modern Warfare 2 was better, but it was Modern Warfare 1. Call of Duty, the original Call of Duty 4 kickstarted everything and perfected what Doom and GoldenEye started as far as realistic first-person shooters. So my pick is Call of Duty 4 for the decade of the 2000s. I will never forget when I was 20 in my very first apartment, I had the Xbox 360, and one of the first games I ever got was Call of Duty 4 because I was floored by it, and I had to have it. So, and I just remember me and my roommate staying up late through the night playing online Call of Duty 4. It was different. It was different. That was it. All the talking shit, all the craziness. Man, I'm telling you, Call of Duty 4, it's not, again, I tapped out of these games. But if I'm being unbiased here, I'm telling you, Call of Duty 4 defined that decade, in my opinion.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
Before you transition to the 2010s?
Yes.
All right.
Yeah.
This is tough, and I honestly don't have the answer. I really don't.
Okay.
What game was more important to video games as a whole? I'm not going just the first one, because obviously Halo 2 was superior, but I'm gonna say this. They both. Which one was bigger? Grand Theft Auto 3 or Halo 1? Which had the bigger impact?
Oh man.
Well, that, I mean,
I'm gonna say Halo simply for the fact that it was more universal.
Yeah.
For people to pick up and play.
I mean, it was multiplayer, but like,
yeah, but the thing is, Grand Theft Auto 3 had some controversy. It was mature, whereas Halo, I think, was teen. And I think there was more
Halo's
people.
Mature, I think.
I feel like more people played Halo over. I feel like more people played Halo than Grand Theft. I mean, both were fucking big. Joe, you
more people owned the PlayStation, though. Remember, like, didn't PS2 sell
like
100 million?
GTA took some time to actually warm up to people.
I guess less.
Halo was kind of warm right off the bat.
Yeah, Halo was an overnight phenomenon, really.
Because, like, if you think, like, I think Grand Theft Auto 3, with the open world stuff, like, what we got, Crackdown, Saints Row, they started trying to do more games. I just feel like Grand Theft Auto created a whole new genre, whereas Halo really, you know, we had GoldenEye, we had Doom, Perfect Dark was okay on N64. Like, we had other shooters.
Then we got Titanfall, Metroid Prime. We got, like, other, like, space shooter games. I mean, look at Dead Space. Like, you're trying to tell me if to counter what you just said, like, I mean, yeah, there's other Grand Theft Auto ripoffs, but there's been other Halo ripoffs, too.
But, you know, like, the conversation we're having is just, like, that was the difference between Xbox and PlayStation, though, because if you look at PlayStation, we had Metal Gear, Final Fantasy, Devil May Cry, and Grand Theft Auto.
God of War.
The same winner. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, God of War came later, but I'm just thinking of, like, that 2001-2002 era. It was like, Xbox had the great multiplayer games, but PlayStation was where all the good single-player stuff
was.
Oh,
Fist, you didn't mention Scarface in the game.
Shout out to Scarface. Yeah, shout out
to
Scarface.
That was good!
I forgot about that.
I always saw it, never played it.
Oh my God, it was great!
The Godfather got a game, too. Godfather got a game.
Sopranos got a game. Sopranos.
Yeah, but dude, the Scarface was legitimately good.
Yeah.
It's hard to compare the two. It's hard to compare Halo with GTA because GTA, they both did some really impactful stuff. GTA was like the beginning for open world. So you didn't have to play mission to mission to mission. You could actually explore. Whereas Halo kind of initiated campaigns. You know, we had campaigns before that, but this is what actually brought it to life and did it right. So they both did different things as best as they could.
That freaking Halo background music, man.
Oh, I know.
Okay, I'm just going back to what I said earlier. If you take away Grand Theft Auto 3, I think the PlayStation still exists, obviously, and still is huge. You take away Halo, there is no Xbox. Yeah.
Yeah, literally. That's what I'm saying.
That's my argument. Is I just feel like if you're coming with more impactful, I gotta say it was Halo over GTA.
Yeah.
I gotta play devil's advocate. I think Grand Theft Auto saved PlayStation. I think it did, because if you look, Metal Gear was on PS1. It wasn't, you know, it's good, but it wasn't saving the system. I think when you thought of PlayStation, you thought of Grand Theft Auto, because Xbox didn't get Grand Theft Auto 2 years later. I mean, that was the flagship game of PlayStation for like a good 5 years. Was like,
but PlayStation has. Here's another thing: the PlayStation and Xbox, to a lesser degree, they both have their niche games for niche audiences. Like, I'm gonna say the sports games, racing games, fighting games, all those. So if you're into that, you know, you're gonna buy those new games for those specific types of games. Anyway, so, you know, it's not that it saved it, you know, I mean, there's always a lot of options for different people.
Yeah, that's well said, Josh.
Yeah.
But Fist does bring up a good point, though. It's really thought-provoking, honestly.
Because I want to shout out Guitar Hero and my sports games, Madden, all those.
Yeah. Oh, I saw some.
I can't.
We're going to get to the sports games. Don't worry.
Okay. All right.
So I guess we're ready to move on to what we're going to do is the final decade here. The 2010s, which honestly can still be felt right now because we're still really early in this decade. And there's a lot of carryover here. So that being said, Shaquille Oatmeal of the Round 1 Podcast. By the way, everybody, please subscribe to the Round 1 Podcast. Great podcast. If you love Nerd Cage Live, you love anime, if you love sports, and if you love video games, TV shows, anime, you got to subscribe to the Round 1 Podcast. I promise you won't regret it. That being said, Chuck, go ahead, man. I just wanted to big you up.
I appreciate that, by the way. There's a lot of games from this generation that, you know, you could make a statement for. But it was a choice between two games for me that I don't really play, but I recognize their impact. And I might get roasted for it, but I think they're two of the most impactful games of this whole decade.
Yeah.
And it's because they're still being played today. I won't say both. I'll say one of them. Okay. Just in case somebody says the other one.
Yeah.
But I'm going to pick Minecraft.
Yeah.
Whoa!
Damn it, Shaq. You and I are like, we're like the hive mind, dude. Because I was going to say Minecraft as well. But that's all right. I have another one too, but I'll save it though.
You Minecraft know what? To add to Shaq's argument, I don't mean to interrupt, but like, Minecraft currently holds the record for the most copies sold for any video game.
Yeah.
If you want to make, there you go. There's an argument right fucking there. It's the number one selling video game in the world. It holds the record.
Yeah.
It surpassed Tetris.
That's not surprising at all.
Tetris held the record for like 25 years or something like that.
It's
Minecraft broke it.
Grand Theft Auto 4? I thought like GTA 5 was like the highest grossing game.
It might be highest grossing after all the add-ons, but even that, Minecraft is still probably like after all the add-ons. I remember, you said it first, Shaq, so you first. What else? What do you think about
Minecraft? Was like a phenomenon when it came out. It was like, I just heard about it and was like, oh, that sounds cool. So I like downloaded it on my computer. Me and one of my friends got into like a server and we were messing around on there. And then when it came out on consoles, it'd be like my whole friend group and stuff, we were like building worlds and doing shit. And it was, even to this day, man, like the shit that people do on Minecraft is like mind blowing.
Is it better than The Sims?
Oh, yeah.
Well, yeah, it's like different.
It's different, but it's Minecraft. You could create The Sims in Minecraft. Like,
oh, wow.
The shit people do in Minecraft is insane.
Yeah,
I've seen people
go on YouTube and just have a field day.
Build a full games inside of Minecraft. Like, it's incredible.
I remember my friend Seth was like, yeah, I've been playing this game in like early 2011. Like you said, yeah, it's a cool little game. It's called Minecraft. I watched him play and I'm like, what is this fucking shit? What is this shit that you're fucking playing? And then $4 billion later, you know, when whatever Mahjong is a company that bought.
Mojang.
Dude, the top YouTubers right now, the platform we're on, they're playing Minecraft. And I will say this, I didn't play Minecraft, but I did play games like Blood and Bacon and other games that have like that style, Paint the Town Red, you know, the Minecraft style, the whole genre, like it started its own like aesthetic of games. So yeah, I've come to like that blocky aesthetic that I didn't like initially.
I got no argument. I'm just going based on sales. Well, I mean, obviously, Josh, when he said, you know, everyone's playing it, and then you go on YouTube, but like, but to me, it's the sales. Like,
I don't know if I'm the only one with kids, but kids, like, they're all about Minecraft. They don't know any other fucking game, you know, other than Minecraft.
I've seen my daughter does, but kids play it. Like, I'm seeing the chat here. There's people who, you know, their kids still play it, this and that. So I have no argument. It's definitely not my pick, but she's got an argument there. But Fist Vegas. You're chomping at the bit right now, so go ahead, man.
This is tough for me, okay? This is really the hardest one I had to do. Because in 2008, after, you know, they just murdered Gears of War after, so I turned into a Madden pro. And from 08 to about 2013, I would travel across the country and compete in Madden tournaments. So that was kind of my thing. So as I got older, all I played was Madden and 2K. That's it. You know, I stopped buying video games. So I must say, I was a beast. I was deity level in a lot of Madden. So this is hard for me. But I will probably have to say, the best game of the 2010s, it might be Madden 13.
Okay.
I was a beast in that game. I had my Green Bay Packers. That was Aaron Rodgers at like 80 speed. He had 99 throw power. Had my man Greg Jennings on one side, Jordy Nelson on the other, Clay Matthews on defense. I won a lot of money on Gaming Saloon. Shout out to GamingSaloon.com. Won a lot of money on Gaming Saloon that year.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I traveled to many people's houses and took a lot of freaking money. Thank God I'm still here and didn't get shot, stabbed, killed in the process. I put in a lot of work.
No one's going to cross Fisk.
That was the height of Madden Nation also. Like, I don't know if it's specifically 2013. I don't know if you competed in that, Fisk, but I love Madden, but I wasn't good enough to play in like Madden Nation or whatever. You know?
Man, I took a lot of people that you saw on the Madden bus, got their money talking about me too.
No, okay,
Joe and I will tell you, they have Madden tournaments in Syracuse everywhere every year.
Yeah.
I was going to say Madden 10 because I was in college at the time and I flew
to
the
Hall of Fame. That was 09.
Right, yeah, that's why I didn't say it because I was like, I remember I flew to the Pro Football Hall of Fame to play in a Madden 10 tournament.
I think you're right, though. I think Madden honestly peaked around 13, 14. Even like Madden 25,
because
it felt like a peak.
My favorite was Madden 09.
Oh, yeah.
I loved 09. 09 was a great year. Had my rocket catches with the Chargers that year. Shout out to Phillip Rivers and Vincent Jackson.
All right, my favorite's Madden 23 because it's the newest one. It has the best
Here's the thing, Madden. Is no one going to talk about the Madden curse? How that impacts the world of sports?
Yeah.
Ain't nobody going to talk about that. Like,
I forgot.
Madden had the Madden curse.
Our players don't ever end up on the
Cubs.
Beckham, Beckham was on there, though.
Like, Madden.
You're right. Beckham did get on there. He ain't been the same
since.
He was
on 25, right? And then, that was Barry Sanders was on 25.
Dude, I brought my copy of Madden 13, the Giants training cap, hoping I'd get Odell to sign it.
Who was the guy from the Browns? He was on 12.
Peyton Hillis.
Yeah, he didn't turn into. Well, he was on
12. I should have said 12 was a good year. 12
is good. I'll say this. The NCAA, dude, this is like mind blowing to me. I was in the LGS. The NCAA 13 and 14, bro, they're like hundreds of dollars. They stopped making those games. Like,
they're coming back this year.
I was like, whoa.
The first one since 2014, so it's been 9 years. This is the first
NCAA 14 was like $130. I'm like, wait, what? Is that a mistake? Yep. He's like, no. It's not a mistake. So if you guys have your copies, your old copies of your college games, you know, keep those too.
It's weird because I spent $100 a year to get the Madden, to get the ultimate copy of Madden.
Oh, okay.
And I remember being a kid in the 90s or early 2000s, Dragon Ball GT Final Bout was like $150. And I remember saying, I'll never pay $150 for a game. Well, fast forward about 15, 16 years later, I'm spending $1,000 a year on a video game because I want to get good luck cards. Times have changed.
I spend that on Magic. Not anymore, but I probably spent like $4,000 to whatever on Magic. What about, but Madden Mobile, though, I did play Madden Mobile, too, on my phone. It's easy. It's very addictive to get into it.
You know what? We got to credit Madden.
It's easy.
I think, you know why? Because I think Madden was one of the first games to make you, like, the microtransactions.
Nah. Like, I got to think. I'll look into that because there's definitely other ones that were making
spending
money. Because
there was games that had add-ons, but, like, Madden is like, bro, you're spending $500 a year. Like,
now, what about CSGO? That was probably one of the first ones to do it.
Who's innovated that? Because I know a lot of Jay's picks have been, like, innovator-type picks. Which games kicked off this microtransaction crap? Like, what was the first game?
CSGO, maybe, right?
I feel like EA is notorious for that.
Yeah.
It's got to be FIFA or Madden. That's what I was thinking.
Overwatch was doing it too.
I think Joe's looking it up. I can tell. I know what Joe's looking it up for.
I feel like Madden started, like Madden or some other EA game.
Oblivion was the first one with microtransactions, actually.
Really?
It was first, but I'm talking about like buying the car.
I get where Chris is coming from. Like, it took it to the next level. Like, where people were shelling out like ungodly amount of money for no reason when they didn't have to.
I'm gonna go on a limit thing. I think it was Madden, because once Madden started doing it, then 2K did it, and then THQ did it with the wrestling games, and then you got shooters doing it to get special upgrades for guns and stuff. I think.
Well, no, Halo was. Oh no, that was Infinite though. That came out 2015. Yeah. And Overwatch has had loot boxes, you know.
Yeah.
World of Warcraft, you could buy characters and
Fortnite, I mean, obviously.
That was a separate thing, though.
But that was later on. But yeah, I think Fisk got a point there. Yeah. Microtransactions, and it's EA. It's not just men. Like, EA in general. It's like notorious for it.
So,
Yeah, Josh, go ahead if you want
to
do your
pick. If I can't pick Minecraft, which I was going to, it's okay, Fisk. Shaq, it's all right. I guess my second pick would have to be, because I'm seeing the impact of it now, and I guess I didn't, and I'm going back and replaying The Last of Us Part 1. I'd say like that's one of the most popular games, and a game that a lot of people love and will say it's their favorite game of all time. Not me personally. I do like the game a lot, but I'd say The Last of Us is definitely a candidate.
I had a feeling someone was going to. I figured either you.
You know what's funny, Josh? I have the same exact game.
I knew it for sure.
That's all right.
That's okay. We killed two birds with one stone right here, right now, because we're, you know, it's almost giveaway time, guys. But I had a feeling. I knew someone was going to say Last of Us. I fucking knew it. Again, I've actually never played it, but I've watched the show. And, oh boy, like, I definitely see the argument. I'll say this. I don't know if it's the best game of the decade, but I think it revolutionized storytelling in a game.
Yes.
That would be the one argument, but I can't for the life of me pick it as the best game of the decade.
Since I'm in between both of these, I mean, I'm going to go back with Minecraft. Yeah, that's obviously more, it's the better game. It's more impactful, but or one of those two. Those would be my top two.
Yeah, if I have to rival Minecraft, the only game that can rival Minecraft in a kid's eyes is Fortnite.
Yeah, you're right. I would probably pick Minecraft over, if I had to choose between the two as far as the decade, I'd probably choose Minecraft just because it's been around longer. That's just me.
I can agree with that.
All right, so do I spit my last one?
Go for it.
I'm going to get so much shit. I'm gonna get so much shit here. Okay. The Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild was the best game of the last decade.
I knew you were gonna say that.
It's not even my favorite Zelda game. It's not even my favorite Zelda game, but my god, how many copies it sold. It put the Switch on the map.
Yeah.
Every other platforming game has copied it. Everything from like Sonic Frontier to Joe's goddamn Ginger Jedi game. Everyone's ripping off Breath of the Wild. Breath of the Wild. It put the Switch on the map. Listen, here's my argument. Nintendo was downtrending. Nintendo with the Wii and the Wii U. Nintendo was seeing a sharp decline. The Switch comes out, and what comes with the Switch? The launch title was Breath of the Wild. If you go to YouTube Gaming and search Breath of the Wild, people to this day are finding out shit, exploring shit, finding shit. It's mind-blowing. And it's beautiful. It holds up. I have my problems with it. It's not even my favorite Zelda game, but from outside looking in, and the Switch is now the almost the top-selling game system of all time. It's like it's about to cross that. The Switch is about to cross the most purchased game system of all time, and that's because of Breath of the fucking Wild. And Tears of the Kingdom. And people are hopping. And coming off Tears of the Kingdom right now.
Yeah.
It's because of Breath of the Wild. It's a whole new shade of coat. Breath of the Wild, again, not my favorite game of the decade, not my favorite Zelda game, but from the outside looking in, I think Breath of the Wild is the game of the last decade.
I'm not hating on any of these. Minecraft, The Last of Us, Breath of the Wild, Madden, sure, you know. I mean, these are all great. They're all great.
Shaq and Fist look like they're ready to kill me.
League, and it's very niche. I mean, you know, I'm into the.
It's like the most popular game in the world, or something.
Is it?
It's the most played multiplayer game in the world. I think.
And I know Fist Vegas is going to say, Jason, it's a single player game, and you're right. But my god, like, if I'm looking at the sales, I'm looking at like the Switch. This game's carried the Switch. It's carried the Switch these past few years, and the Switch is the top selling, almost the top selling game system of all time.
Shaquille, I'm sorry, was that your second game, Shaquille? Was that League of Legends?
League of Legends, which is going to be my other one, yeah.
Oh, yeah? Okay.
Or The Witcher. I was going to pick Witcher 3.
Oh, okay.
GTA 5 is one of my favorites, my top 10.
There, yeah.
I said, can set Overwatch, you know, to your League of Legends. I mean, there is an Overwatch League, but any of these are all like very popular good games. Fortnite, you said, Joe, definitely. Yeah. You know, launched a whole store.
As much as I despise it, I can't.
I mean, this decade was really hard to pick. It really was, because part of me was thinking about, well, what about Last of Us, even though it's not my favorite, like, but they're.
I tried to go unbiased because it's favorite.
But
my favorite
also
game.
Think about it. Breath of the Wild came out in 2016. It's 2023.
No, totally, yeah.
That's what I'm saying, the longevity of it, and like...
Well, I had to go really unbiased, or else all my titles would have been Resident Evil games.
Sure.
I mean, like I said, I see everybody's argument here, I really do. So, this is you guys had Minecraft, so in every fucking decade, we all agreed on something, whether it was a game system or a game, but Fist, you're quiet, I'm telling you, sometimes I feel like I betrayed you or something. Like,
no, he just doesn't like any of these stupid ass games like fucking Minecraft.
Two things is happening right now.
Okay.
Number one is about my bedtime, and then number two,
I feel that.
I ain't gonna lie to you, I can't believe I didn't bring up Mass Effect in the 2000s segment, because like I remember Mass Effect was like the first open world space game where you can just travel the planets when you wanted to and stuff.
Okay.
I miss Mass Effect.
I don't know shit about Mass Effect by now. Didn't they fuck it up? Like the last
game? Mass Effect has yet to come, to be perfectly honest, because I think this Mass Effect 4 that's coming is going to be fucking amazing.
I see this one right here and I'm like, I don't want to play that shit because I hear it's like terrible. Like whatever it was. I don't know which one it is, but it's one of
them. I think Mass Effect 2 is probably the best one.
Oh, yeah.
That's what everybody says.
Alright, guys, those are all of our picks for every decade. This was a hell of fun. So here's what we're gonna do. It is giveaway time. But before we do our giveaway, I just want to again, share my. I want to share personal messages with everybody, but I want our guests to go ahead and plug before we do this giveaway. Again, here's what's going to happen, guys. We're going to draw a wheel. We already have all of our entries, and they're already put on a wheel. We're going to spin the wheel of lives. So, unbiased pick. We're going to spin a wheel. Everybody's got a legit chance. We're going to do three spins. First spin will be a $50 Amazon card digital, which I will email you. You got to email me back, and then I'll email you the card. Second spin, $100 Amazon card. You guys will get it on Saturday. You guys will get them on Saturday. And finally, the third spin will be the Xbox Series X. And you have 40, I mean this, you have 40 hours to reply to me. And if you don't reply to me, we're gonna spin again off air and pick another winner. All right, so you have 48 hours, and you gotta give me your shipping address. You better be in US or Canada, all right? That being said, Shaq, go ahead, plug whatever you wanna plug, my guy. Oh yeah, and thoughts on like all these games that we picked overall.
I think it was great choices by everybody. I don't think there was a bad game that anyone said. You know, all these games are impactful in their own ways. But with that being said, go and check me out at the Round One Podcast, as well on YouTube if you want anime, sports, video games, all that type of stuff. Go listen to the podcast. Go check out the YouTube. I do YouTube reactions to sports stuff, like if it's basketball, football, baseball, just historic clips or react to that stuff. And then on Twitch, I stream 5 days a week. Tuesdays and Thursdays are throwback days. Every other day is a modern day. Go check me out there. And thank you again to Nerd Cage for having me.
Absolutely. We always love having you here.
He's on fire!
All right, Fist Vegas, man. Floor is yours. Your thoughts on all these games that we picked, and plug whatever you want to plug, my guy.
I think everybody had great picks. I do think that if we do something like this again, we need to do like for like fighting games only or something like that.
Yeah.
Really, you know, really spark some debate because, you know, one guy goes action, the other guy goes RPG, the other guy goes fighting.
Right.
I would love to just have it like us five just duke it out in one category for the best game of the decade. I think that would be good.
Yeah, that's a good idea. We can run it back.
Hell yeah!
And y'all can find me. Look, just type in Fist Vegas on any platform and follow, subscribe, like, engage with the comment. All right. At the end of the day, trying to build a social media army over here. So Instagram, Twitter, TikTok, YouTube, just type in Fist Vegas and follow, man. You know the vibes.
Hashtag Fisk Unit.
Y'all go ahead and get Fisk Unit tough. All right, when you Fisk Unit tough, you can catch bullets with your teeth, you can outrun Usain Bolt, and you can beat lions and crocodiles in one-on-one fights, okay? You get Fisk Unit tough, you're going to be a better person.
Amen. And I just want to add that you've been my voice of reason for the last few years, and we're happy to have you here. I listen to you every goddamn day, dude. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
All right, Josh, anything you need to plug, my guy?
Nothing I need to plug. I haven't really been on YouTube. You can find me here more so than even on my damn channel. I don't just don't talk.
All right, we appreciate it. Again.
But I will say this. I'll do you one better about the this competition that, even though it wasn't really a competition. People in the chat, let's do like either a poll or something. Maybe go on Nerd Cage on Facebook, Nerd Cage Nation. What do you think about our picks? What do you think was the best decade, you know, or game of the decade for each one that we picked? And were we wrong? Did we say dumb shit? Did you like what we had to say? That's that.
Joe will put up a post, and then we would love to see you guys reply. Yeah. Absolutely.
Pick a winner, you know. Do it.
All right, and then Joe, I know you got to go to work, but go ahead, tell them what we're doing tomorrow and Tuesday and next Thursday.
All right, tomorrow we go back to Mortal Kombat 11 Aftermath.
Ooh.
Yep.
So that should be loads of fun with all the Mortal Kombat news that's out in the world right now. On Tuesday, we go back to Metroid Prime Remastered, which has been loads of fun. And then next Thursday, That's the day. Mark your calendars, people, because Brian Glynn, the original Shao Kahn, will be gracing us with his presence, so get your questions ready.
Yes. Okay. So we're going to spin. Again, I just want, let me just full screen myself real quick, because I got an ego here. Again, I want to thank everybody who, we had a surge in the channel when this contest went, we've been running the contest for a year, but when we announced that we were ready to take entries, we had a surge. Thank you. Thank you to everybody who entered. Thank you to everybody who screenshotted and shared. It helped us. Thank you to everyone who supported us from the beginning, through the lineup changes, through the good and the bad, the late streams, the technical problems, the watch party problems. Like, thank you to everybody who stuck by us. Thank you to everybody who participates in Nerd Cage Nation, Discord, and all that good stuff. I promise you guys, we're going to work hard to keep growing this channel. We're going to work hard to get more guests. We're going to work hard to do more giveaways. We'll probably do more smaller giveaways after this, but if you guys keep making our channel grow, we'll do another big giveaway. So, best of luck to everybody who entered, and we look forward to doing this, and we're excited. So that being said, Joe, say it.
It's giveaway time.
Do it!
It's giveaway time!
Yes! So I'm going to pull up the wheel here, the wheel of names. So hold on, I got to switch to the wheel of names here. Okay, everything's ready. Okay, and let me just pull it up on our... I got to keep switching back and forth. Excuse me, guys. Whew, I'm nervous here. All right, there's the wheel, guys. There's the entries. We had over 30 entries. This is for the $50 Amazon card. And I better write this down so I don't forget get the three winners here.
Well, it's on. It's, it'll be on the stream. You can just read, whatever. It's fine.
Yeah.
Put it in a notepad or something.
Yeah, I don't know if I have a notepad. It's whatever. Here we go, guys. Here we go. Spin. And the winner for the $50 Amazon card, Barra. Barra is our winner of the $50 Amazon card. I will email you. You have 48 hours to email me back, and I will email you the digital card. Congratulations to Barra. Thank you. So let me take him off the wheel now. So now you guys' chances increase a little bit. All right. For the $100 Amazon gift card. Here we go.
Barra, thank
you. Alan C. is the winner of the $100 Amazon card. And I think Alan's got two entries in here. Yes, he does. Again, your chances increase, everybody. $100. Again, Alan, if you're watching, you have 48 hours to reply back to me when I email you tonight. And then I'll get it to you on Saturday. All right, guys. Before we spin the... for the final spin, guys, I gotta play this promo real quick.
Finish him. I am Shao Kahn. Bow to me. Feel the power of Shao Kahn.
That's right, Nerd Cage Nation. Mark your calendars for Thursday, May 25th at 9 o'clock Eastern Standard Time as Brian Glynn, the original Shao Kahn for Mortal Kombat 2 and 3, guest on Nerd Cage Live.
Toasty!
Oh yeah, where were we? Here we go. Last spin for the Xbox Series X. And I'm going to say this right here right now. You have 48 hours to reply to me with your full information or we're picking somebody else. Here we go, guys. The winner for the Xbox. Here we go. And the winner is... Sean B is our winner. If you are in the chat, I will email you. So that is our winner. Sean B is our winner.
Congratulations.
Yeah,
congratulations.
Yeah, Sean. Yeah, fine. Yeah, good job, Sean.
Hold on. I'm going to let me Xbox. Play the. There we go.
Xbox so, man now.
Congratulations.
Yes. So congrats to our winner. And again, everybody, thank you to everybody who entered. I mean that. And for those who did not win, we're going to do more giveaways.
Don't worry, we'll do more.
We'll do more giveaways. So we appreciate this, guys. All right, so I guess we can pretty much call it a night here. Is there anything else, anything else from anybody?
Good, man.
All right.
No, man.
So, as always, again, congrats to our three winners. We pretty please ask you to like, comment, subscribe, ring that bell, and spread that shit like syphilis. So, USA from yours truly, Syracuse, New York, New Jersey, New York City, North Carolina, to all our friends around the world at Nerd Cage Live on paper, Round One Podcast, and Fisk Vegas Blue. As always, enjoy life. Stay safe. Eat your vegetables. Go to the gym. Do your push-ups. Be excellent to each other. Congrats to our winners once again. Thank you to everybody's support. God bless and good night. We'll see you on Twitch tomorrow night.
Good night.
Ooh, trying to get out of the nerd cage, are ya? Well... before you go, hit that subscribe button. And if you're really intrigued, ring that bell. Thank you for dropping by. Until next time, tell everyone you know about Nerd Cage Live! Ah!